years of my life are bountiful and bold. The purple glow of indigo, the gleam of green and gold, the splendor of a sunrise, the dazzle of a flame, the glory of a rainbow, I've put them all to shame. No quiet browns or grays, I'll take my days instead and fill them till they overflow with rose and cherry red. And should this sunlit world grow dark one day, the colors of my life will leave a shining light to show the way.
The colors of my life are softer than a breeze, the silver gray of eiderdown, the dappled green of trees, the splendor of a wheat field, the dazzle of a seed, the crystal of a raindrop is all I'll ever need. Your reds are much too bold. In gold I find no worth. I'll fill my life with sage and brown, the colors of the earth. And if from by my side our love should roam, the colors of my life will lead a shining light to bring you home.
The colors of my life,
the colors of my life,
are bountiful and bold,
are softer than a breeze,
the purple glow of indigo,
the silver gray of eiderdown,
the gleam of green and gold,
the dappled green of trees,
the splendor of a sunrise,
the amber of a wheat field,
the dazzle of a flame,
the hazel of a seed,
the glory of a rainbow,
the crystal of a raindrop.
I'll put them all to shame.
Are all I'll ever need.
No quiet browns and grays,
your reds are much too bold.
I'll take my days instead.
In gold I find the worth,
and fill them till they overflow.
I'll fill my days with sage and brown,
with rose and cherry red,
the colors of the earth.
And should this sunlit world grow dark one day, the colors of my life will lead a shining light to show.
Russell Ames was my musical partner in crime. He was 35 years my senior, but we were musically two peas in a pod. We hit it off from day one. He had an amazing life story. Well-traveled, incredibly bright, educated at that school in Cambridge, as he would say, played Carnegie Hall, accompanied the University Men's Glee Club for 35 years, and toured as accompanist for the great Irish singer John McNally. And he loved his work as director of admissions at Horace Mann and Riverdale Country Day School in the Bronx, two very prestigious schools. His roster of friends could fill an entire theater. My partner Kevin and I hosted a 90th birthday party for him, just about 65 of his most intimate friends. He was one of the most brilliant, soul-connected musicians I have ever had the honor to play with. And believe me, I have played with some of the best. He could be wickedly funny, darkly humorous, brutally honest. But he could always laugh at his own shortcomings, even when they were being highlighted by someone else, and even if the thing being highlighted was a bit close to the bone. His depth of honesty and candor would never cease to amaze. Very few speak such truth so authentically. Now, with all that being said, the everlasting thing about Russell, it's hard to find a word for him, right? Was his great generosity of spirit and his enormous heart. We created together from the moment that we met until not long before his transition. His nickname for me was Diva Sprite, which I will honor till the end of my days. Now this afternoon, we are here to get to celebrate our wonderful Russell. Now, my story with Russell started about 15 years ago. We put together many afternoon evenings of song. Some of the titles in our catalog were Songs of the Storytellers, celebrating some of the great composers of Broadway, Broadway Babes, celebrating some of the leading ladies of Broadway, The Quotable Woman, housed in our own wonderful Westport Library, celebrating some of history's greatest gals through their quote and song. Now, one of our last concerts was here, actually our very last concert was here in the Hand House in 2019, entitled Ensley and Ames At It Again. And that was an appropriate title because we were always at it, debating about what to present and how to present it. Now, I always felt patter was important as a through line for our musical stories. Russell did not. I won. I have spent many hours tucked in the crook of this piano, listening and singing and listening to those amazing stories. Now, I always would say to him, we should have an afternoon on stage with you telling your stories. And they usually started out simply enough with things like, did I ever tell you about the time that I introduced Gypsy Rosalie to Gloria Vanderbilt? Well, one afternoon I was talking about the great baritone Robert Merrill. And he said, oh, I introduced Bob to Frank. I said, Frank who? He said, Frank Sinatra. And it went on and on and on like that. And that was our Russell. He did not tell these stories to be grand. They were just basically a recounting of his life experience. Our first collaboration, Songs of the Storytellers, was on the stage of the Depot in Westport. And this is the story that Russell imparted to a captivated crowd. Let me move this so everyone can see. We're going to run it back. I hope. Now, Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Can I sort of interrupt and say something about the next song?
Sure, go ahead.
In 1950, Gertrude Lawrence was married to a Broadway producer called Richard Aldrich, whose son, David, was a classmate of mine in college and a member of the Hasty Pudding Club. That year, the Pudding Club needed very much to sell a lot of tickets so that they'd cover the cost of the production of the show, which had not been the case in the previous year. So the president hit upon the idea that he would name a Hasty Pudding Club Woman of the Year or Man of the Year, the idea being to get a person of such celebrity that we'd rouse the Boston press into coming, covering the show, giving us some free publicity. And David's relationship to Gertrude Lawrence was well known, and he was persuaded to ask mom, stepmom, if she would be the woman of the year. And she said yes, and that was very good news. The stars of the 40s and 50s were royalty. They were not like the twits whose antics People magazine. People like Rex Harrison. Wilson, Cholula Bankhead, the Lutz, Cary Grant, Noel Coward, that crowd, were royalty. They were kings and queens. They behaved like such, and they were treated like such. And Gertrude Lawrence was the queen of the whole crowd. She was named the first lady of the American theater, and certainly in London she could have had the same appellation with reason. Her coming brought out the Boston press. They were great. All the papers came, and they covered it not only as a news story, but they brought the drama critics as well, and they covered the show very generously and attractively. And as a result, we sold out 4 weeks in Cambridge and a week in New York, and one night in New Canaan, Connecticut. Don't ask, I haven't a clue. Some rich alumnus, I guess, wanted to say. Opening night arrived, and a great long limousine pulled up to the Pudding Club on Holyoke Street, and out got Gertrude, with more diamonds than Harry Winston ever dreamed possible. And wearing what A. Burroughs shortly thereafter would write in a line for Nathan Detroit, more mink than a mink. Well, they trooped up the stairs and into the auditorium, and pandemonium broke out. It was a wonderful moment. The audience rose and applauded. The flash bulbs were going like mad. And they swung down the central aisle to their seats in the third row on the aisle. And they stayed in their seats, unlike Ames sometimes does, for which God be praised, because those two people in those two seats could not have sneaked out anyhow. It was a great night. We had a large cast party afterwards on stage, and they joined us. And everybody was drinking and singing and what have you. I'd written a couple of songs for the show, so I was at the piano when somebody yelled out, "Miss Lawrence, will you sing for us?" And I thought, here comes the, I've got a sore throat, I've got a sick headache, I don't have my music, where is my accompanist? And so I just hit the intro to a song that she'd made famous called My Ship in Lady in the Dark. And right on cue, she came in and she sang it, and it was a big hit. And then she was getting into this gig pretty happily. And she said, "Do you know This Is New?" And I said, "Yes, I did." So we sang This Is New. And then she said, "You know, I've got an idea. Dear David, will you go fetch my portfolio from the cloakroom?" Dear David fetched. And out came, from her briefcase, came a piece of musical manuscript. It couldn't have been an original. I can't imagine that Rogers would have let it out of his hands. But it probably was a very good photocopy. At any rate, she said it was in Dick's hand. And it was a song called Hello, Young Lovers. And she said, "You know, I have to learn 6 of these songs before our rehearsals begin next month. Would you show me how this goes?" Well, there having been only 2 weeks since the last great diva asked me to teach them, I said, "Why not?" And so we flopped down on the piano bench, and I poked out the tune, the vocal line, and the left hand, a little bit of the harmony, so she can get the drift of the thing. And I tell you, I have never been in the presence of such sustained and intense concentration in my life. She worked at that song with me for about 5 minutes, saying, I'd play the line, she'd say, "Could we do that again? And let me hear how that is again." In 5 minutes, that woman stood up, and the crowd quieted down again. And she said, "In March, we are going to open a show in Boston called The King and I. And I'm in it, and I would like you all to come as my guests to opening night. David would arrange the tickets." Well, we all went, but we had to pay our own way, I'm sorry. But she said, "In order to persuade you to come, I want you to hear the song which I hope will be the hit of the show." And by God, then she sang Hello, Young Lovers. It was not without flaws. We together rewrote a little bit of Rogers, I think. Made it better, worse, who knows. But we did it. And the whole thing made for a very large evening in the life of a 20-year-old kid. The kid is now in his 80th year, and clearly in his anecdotage is the best. But I'm still here. I'm still playing. And it's a great pleasure for me to play the same song for another great diva of New York City.
That is well worth clapping for. I miss him. Now, Russell and I were both huge musical theater geeks. We both loved Rodgers and Hammerstein, Schmidt and Jones, Lerner and Lowe. And I personally have a great place in my heart for the wonderful lyricist Johnny Mercer. So we would often do a Mercer tribute, and we would often sing Moon River. And every time we would rehearse, we would get to the lyric, "Two drifters off to see the world. There's such a lot of world to see." He would relish that lyric because that's how he lived his life. I feel so blessed to have known him, to have created art and music with him, as so many of us in this room have. I also feel grateful to have called him my partner in musical crime. Now, a small footnote. Today I'm going to try and keep it together. However, if at any moment I become overwhelmed by emotion, don't worry, it'll pass. Talk amongst yourselves. And once I regain my composure, we will continue with the program.
Crossing you in style someday. Oh, dream maker, you heartbreaker, wherever you're going, I'm going your way. Two drifters off to see the world, there's such a lot of world to see. We're after the same rainbow's end, waiting round the bend, my huckleberry friend, Moon River.
I would bring Russell new material to try and edge him beyond 1979. Those of you who know him know how funny that is. And he often would say, as only Russell could, "This is crap." And then when I would arrive for our next rehearsal, I'd hear him playing the same damn song. And he'd say, "I love this. I've changed my mind. It's my favorite." This next song is one of those. It was a liberated marriage. We shared the household chores, of course. We understood each other's feelings right down to the day of our sensible divorce. I did not ask him for a penny. I'd had my liberated training. So off he went with his hair of bronze to find a life like a healed bronze. I got my rest from the drugs he did. He got his quest, I got the kid, and oh, I was not complaining. My husband found himself his ashram, lost 40 pounds and went through hell. Then one day he came back from limbo, found himself some bimbo, and moved to a New Rochelle. I raised my son and I had lovers. My choices sometimes take explaining. I'd meet some guy, my friends would scoff. He'd stay a while, I'd drive him off. I kept my space, preserved my turf. 6 months, I sent him back to surf. And oh, I was not complaining. And now my son's halfway through college. I pay tuition like a fine. I'm still this feisty freelance writer, resume well honed at a well-toned 49. I know that getting work is harder. Each job I want takes more campaigning. And those sweet young things who hire me now, those MBAs make it 300 thou, who smile and ask what I have done when they got their jobs from the fights I won. Oh, they should all stay home and have babies. But I'm not complaining. Each day with him was madness, as I have spent my life maintaining. But more and more I recall the joy of my golden dream of my lost boy. Our life was life in the twilight zone, but no worse than a life alone. Chose my way, and I'm not complaining. Thank you. Thank you. Now, as I said, Russell had a vast number of friends from all walks of time and place. And one of those is the wonderful Peter Slocum, who I would like to ask to come to the stage to share his reflections on Russell. I may have to go find him first, though. Talk amongst yourselves.
No, that's fine. I probably met Russell Ames earlier in my life than anybody else here. It was at the end of an extraordinarily, excruciatingly long bus ride up Route 22, before anybody dreamed of the Northway, from the shores of Long Island Sound, where the YMCA was based, all the way almost to Ticonderoga, where the YMCA camp, Mohican, was located on the east shore of Lake George. And this is where Russ was, the musical director, the assistant director, the director of all musicals, the counselor to young counselors, all in all, invigorating spirit. This is the place that I went at age 10. I assumed Russell was 55, you know, was a senior guy and everything. He wasn't even 30, I've since discovered, but he was a senior person in this environment and somebody who had a major impact on my life there at the camp and in a number of other areas too. The camp was a, as I said, basic, even primitive place, no running water except in the mess hall, where Russell held forth every morning after breakfast with a piano in the corner and an infectious enthusiasm, pumping away on the keyboard, just pounding out songs of Rodgers and Hammerstein, other Broadway hits, a little bit of traditional ballads here and there, and of course, the odd bits of humor that he threw in. He had a crowd of 70, 80 boys who weren't very good singers, of course, but his infectious enthusiasm carried us along. His infectious enthusiasm carried us along in a lot of ways. As a leader, I remember as a counselor, young counselor, going to him, because I stayed at this camp off and on for 12 years into my first year in college, and he was somebody who had a major impact in terms of helping us young kids become counselors and deal with kids who were obnoxious, incapable of a canoe paddle, or any other, wetting their beds still when they should not have been. And he was somebody, I don't know if it was in his job title, but he was certainly somebody that I went to and other people went to for advice on dealing with kids. He was had an infectious sort of can-do enthusiasm that I'm not sure came through in the same way that in the video we saw here, but it was just sort of, we can do this, you buck up, let's work on it together and we'll be fine. And we did crazy things, when you think back on it, or seem like it, by going on these incredible 3 and 4 day high peaks mountain trips with two counselors and eight kids and no tents, just a few ponchos and sleeping bags. We went on canoe trips up Lake George, through Ticonderoga, Champlain, down to the Champlain Canal, all the way to the Erie Canal, out to Amsterdam, and then the truck would come pick us up, and everybody was fine. It was sort of, wouldn't dream of doing that now, it doesn't seem to me, but it was no problem. That was the kind of thing that we were able to do at the camp, and I think Russ was definitely part of the group that made that possible. That camp was obviously a gateway to the Adirondacks for Russell. It was a gateway to the Adirondacks for me too, because I ended up living, my wife and I lived down the slope on Cascade Mountain from where Russell's ashes were scattered. And so I too, thank you, Mr. Ames.
I love that, he was 10. I can see Russell in the dining hall. Anyway, another one of Russell's musical tribesmen is our very own Hans Himmelein. And I would like him to come up and tell a little bit of his story and do a couple of numbers with the fabulous Jennifer Moore.
playing music with Russell, and I had the good fortune to have played with him many times over the years. We both liked Cole Porter, so we mostly played Cole Porter and other show tunes. The amazing thing about Russell was that he had perfect pitch and he could play in any key. So the first time we played together, I said, Russell, I'm in the key of E, so I think that's your key of G. And he looked at me and said, just play. So I started playing, and by the second or third note, he was right with me, and he was all over the piano. And he was just such a joy to play music with. He was such a wonderful musician. So here's to Russell.
Another one of Russell's great musical tribesmen is the talented Jairus French, who spent many hours with Russell making music in their musicales, which I would like to ask her to come to the stage and share a little. Is this good for you?
Not a good sign. And also, I forgot my music.
I was joking last night that we don't have any union professionals running the house, but we're working on it. I borrowed this from Jerry. She at least has a right to use it.
Oh, yes. I met Russell at one of our many musicales, and those were gatherings of adult musicians in the area that, you know, none of us were professional, but we all enjoyed playing. We just never had a venue to play in. So we would gather at sometimes Mary Lou's house and sometimes other people's homes, whoever could accommodate the crowd for that day. And that's where I met Russell. And we started playing some things together, me on violin, naturally, and he would accompany on piano. And then he had the idea, or somebody had the idea, that we should do a recital, just the two of us, at the Westport Library. So we started working on that, and it was really fun working with him. We did some Bach and Beethoven and Rachmaninoff, but he really loved Brahms. And we did one movement of one sonata, but as I was telling the folks last night, he kept sneaking ahead to the next one because he really loved that one more, and he would play it and start singing along with it. He just loved it. And I hated a disappointment, so sorry, we got to do sonata number one. I can't, you know, but he loved everything musical, you know, no matter what type of music it was. He was just amazing. Although I'm not so sure he would like rap. Yeah, that might. That's a little bit like patter, so you know. Maybe. All right, so Rose is graciously consented to accompany me on this little Grieg piece, which just a lot of fun. It's got some quirky spots, which I enjoy, and we'll make some music thinking of Russell. Thank you.
Russell loved any kind of classical music. Brahms, Schumann, Liszt, any language, German, French, Italian, you name it, he loved it. But he had a really special place in his heart for Gilbert and Sullivan operettas. So we are going to invite the fabulous Jennifer Moore and Rose Chancellor to the stage to share some of it with us.
Thank you.
pleasure. Russell could play, whoops, is this working? Yes. Russell could play any of these genres at the drop of a hat in any key. And that brings me to another amazing artist that Russell had great admiration and affection for. And that is the lady to my right, Miss Jennifer Moore, who's going to introduce the classical part of the portion of the concert and share her reflections of Russell.
My teacher voice. One of the things I loved about seeing Russell at our shows, and he came to every school production in the region, every single one, and he'd sit in the front row, usually close to the pianist, which didn't make us nervous at all. And I know he knew my name, but he never used it. It was always, hey, Toots, come here. And I'd sit with him for a bit, and we'd talk about music, about teaching. And it was really important to him and for me that no matter whether our kids could find a note in a bucket or whether they could keep a beat, that we always gave them our very best selves at the piano. And he got such a kick out of the earnest attempts of any kid on any stage. And it was a joy. Excuse me, to spend time with him before the shows for those lessons and pep talks. So we were doing a production at the Essex Theater Company, a production of Gypsy at the time. And so I was playing, it was just a piano for the accompaniment. And I noticed he's sitting in the corner and I thought, uh-oh. So he was clearly enjoying himself. And so I went over at intermission to visit with him. And I said, I can't you come to these two. You're amazing. Thank you so much for spending time with us. And he said, well, I'm leaving. And I said, okay. He said, well, he said, the reason I came is because he was very dear friends with Gypsy Rose Lee. He taught her children. And he came to honor her memory. So that's my Russell tribute today. I want to introduce someone that, if you come to our concerts, you're very familiar with, our dear friend, and such an inspiration, Marilyn Reynolds.
Thank you. I did not get to know Russell at all well. I did meet him a few times and heard him play. And I was in a chorus briefly with Susan, who's backstage, and he accompanied a few times. But I thought very much, very highly of him. But a very close friend of mine worked with him quite a bit, and he was on her lips all the time. And that was Sandra Lovell, who some of you may know. They both passed away around the same time. She died a little later last year. Sorry. But so anyway, Sandra briefly lived with me before her death. And at the time, she would sit in her room, and she had a little cassette player, and she had all these cassettes of her and Russell going over. She was a wonderful singer in her earlier years, and going over opera arias. And she just would sing along with them at age 92. So I heard Russell upstairs, and she would talk about him wonderfully all the time. So that was my involvement with Russell Ames. And then I just want to let you know that I'm going to play, Jen and I are going to play a couple of lullabies. And you can think of them as lullabies for Russell Ames, if you like. They're both by French composers. The French word for lullaby is berceuse. And the first one is one I had never heard before, and I find it delightful. And the second one is rather well known. Although somebody who was here last night, who is a major string player in the area, said she'd never heard it. She's not a violinist, but, but she is a string player. So I don't know. Maybe you haven't heard it. The second one's rather popular. The first one I've never heard, and I think they're lovely. The first one is by Saint-Saëns and the second one by Fauré. I think it's printed.
Thank you. teaches music here in Elizabethtown at the school. She does general music and choral studies. She has a long list of amazing and very unusual skills and talents. And I know Russell would have loved her voice had he had the opportunity to hear her, but you will. So welcome, Amy.
Freunde sucht euch dort ein
I'm back. Now, often when I would pop around Russell's, I would enter the back door to have my ears flooded with the most glorious sounds of Schumann and Liszt and HMS Pinafore and, you know, this theme to Umbrellas of Cherbourg. If it takes forever, I will wait for you. Oh,
sorry. Union.
Here comes the union. Best dressed union I've met. Well, anyway, one day I walked through the back door and I heard Russell's voice saying, "Come upstairs and listen to this. I want you to hear brilliance." So I went upstairs to his library where he sat next to his phonograph. I love the fact that he had a phonograph. And he played for me Piaf's triumphant final performance at Carnegie Hall, a song called Lovers for a Day. And after he played the song, I was deeply moved by the pathos of the music and the story of the song. I said, "Russell, that's beautiful, but it's rather dark." And he asked me why I thought it was dark. And I said, "Well, the young couple at the end of the song die." And he said, "No, they were just in bliss-filled sleep." To which I responded, "No, they're dead." So we argued about it a bit longer. And after several listenings of it, he did actually concede that, yes, they had left this mortal coil, but so beautifully that we had to add it to our next program, which we did. So I could not do a tribute to Russell without singing Lovers for a Day. Shine another glass, let the hours pass. Working every day in a cheap cafe. Who am I to care? One more love affair. Still I can't forget, I can see them yet. They came hand in hand. Why can't I forget? For they'd seen the sign that said room to let. The sunshine of love was deep in their eyes. So young, oh so young to be wise. They wanted a place, a small hideaway, a place of their own, if just for one day. The walls were so pale, the covers so thin, but they took that room and heaven walked in. And I closed the door and turned to depart with tears in my eyes and tears in my heart. Shine another glass, make the hours pass. Working every day in a cheap cafe. Who am I to care? One more love affair. Love is nothing new, I have work to do. We found them next day, the way they had planned. So white, so cold, but still hand in hand. The sunshine of love was all they possessed. And so in the sunshine, we laid them to rest. They sleep side by side, two children alone. But I'm sure they found a place of their own. Oh, why must I see the ribbon she wore, the glow on his face when I close the door? Be still, children, still, your shadows depart with tears in my eyes and tears in my heart. Shine another glass, make the hours pass. Working every day in a cheap cafe. Everything is fine till I see that sign. How can I forget? Said room to let. Thank you. Now, I think a little merriment would not go amiss after that last number. Bliss-filled sleep, really. It was getting hard of hearing towards the end. This next song is, as I said, Russell and I were huge musical theater geeks. This next song is a song that he just loved to play, and it really is the story of my high school years. I was so excited because I was going to the High School of Performing Arts. I mean, I was always dying to be a serious actress. Anyway, it's the first day of acting class, and our teacher, Mr. Cart, puts everybody up on stage with their legs around each other, one in back of the other, and he says, okay, we're gonna do improvisations. Now, you're on a bobsled, and it's snowing out, and it's cold. Okay, go. Every day for a week we would try to feel the motion down the hill. Every day for a week we would try to hear the wind rush, feel the chill. And I dug right down to the bottom of my soul to see what I had inside. Yes, I dug right down to the bottom of my soul and I tried. And everybody's going shh, 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 shh. I feel the snow, I feel the car, I feel the air. And Mr. Carr turns to me and he says, okay, Morales, what do you feel? And I said, nothing. I'm feeling nothing. And he said nothing could get a girl transferred. They all felt something, but I felt nothing except the feeling that this bullshit was absurd. But I said to myself, hey, maybe it's genetic. They don't have bobsleds in Southern Cal. Second week, more advanced, and we had to be a table, be a sports car, ice cream cone. Mr. Carp, he would say, very good, except Morales, try Morales all alone. And I dug right down to the bottom of my soul to see how an ice cream felt. Yes, I dug right down to the bottom of my soul and I tried to melt. The kids yelled nothing. They called me nothing. And Carp allowed it, which really makes me burn. They were so helpful. They called me hopeless until I really didn't know where else to turn. And Carp kept saying, Morales, I think you should transfer to girls' high. You'll never be an actress, never. Holy shit. Went to church, praying Santa Maria, send me guidance on my knees. Went to church, praying Santa Maria, help me feel it, pretty please. And a voice from down in the bottom of my soul came up to the top of my head. And a voice from down in the bottom of my soul, here is what it said. This man is nothing. This course is nothing. If you want something, go find a better class. And when you find one, you'll be and I assure you that's what finally came to pass. 6 months later, I heard that Carp had died. And I dug right down to the bottom of my soul. And I cried. 'Cause I felt nothing. I know some of you have heard that before, and it is a true story. His name was not Mr. Karp. I will not name him. Just saying. Anyway, just wanted to say that Russell and I loved Rodgers and Hammerstein. We were a couple of geeks. And we have the great, wonderful treat to have Mr. Michael Bergman come and sing one of their best. He's taller than I am. Now, there was a song that Russell used to sing during his Glee Club days. And
The closer he got to the pearly gates, the more he insisted that we should put this song in our next show. Well, our next show was scheduled for March 26th of 2020. And so COVID closed everything down the week before. And we never had a chance to sing it together publicly until tonight.
Here's my favorite geriatric ballad. It was written by Alan J. Lerner and Burton Lane for a show called Carmelita in 1979. That old April yearning once more is returning, and I have a longing to wander. The leaves may be falling, but April is calling, and the primrose has beckoned me yonder. For one more walk around the garden, one more stroll along the shore, one more memory I can dream upon until I dream no more. For one more time, perhaps the dawn will wait, and one more prayer, it's not too late, to gather one more rose before I say goodbye and close the garden gate. That old voice is saying, it's time to go straying, and April is here to remind me. It's hard to recover the heart of a lover that I left lying somewhere behind me. Oh, one more walk around the garden, one more stroll along the shore, one more memory I can dream upon until I dream no more. One more time, perhaps the dawn will wait, and one more prayer, it's not too late, to gather one more rose before I say goodbye and close the garden gate. One more rose before I close the garden.
One of Russell's most cherished artistic experiences was touring the world and Europe with the great Irish singer John McNally. And he would often recount stories of their magnificent music and their concerts. And it was a really wonderful memory for him. And as he neared the end of his time on this planet, I would find him more often listening to these old songs from that time, singing Irish ballads at the top of his lungs with the living room fire ablaze. So it seemed to me, this is a fitting Irish farewell toast to my dear friend. For all the money that e'er I had, I spent it in good company, and of all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit, in memory now I can't recall, so fill to me that parting glass. Good night and joy be with you. The terror I had, they are sorry for my going away, and for all the
comrades that e'er I had, they'd wish me one more day to stay. And should it fall unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, then I'll gently rise and I'll softly call good night and joy be with you all. So fill to me that parting glass, good night and joy.
Well, at least I waited to the end to lose it. This next song was Russell and I's signature song, and it is the last. On a wall, in a house, in Reseda, there's a poster held up by two nails and a pin. It's my daddy, the actor, about to die with his boots on. He's the man standing up there beside Errol Flynn. He got third or fourth billing at the end of each picture. Well, that don't mean much, he would say with a grin. But he'd hold my hand tight as he pointed his name out. Only four or five names down below Errol Flynn. And now fame, it is fleeting, and stars, they keep falling and staying right up there. That's the business of art. And luck is some, and she passes by others. Disappointment and bourbon are hard on the heart. Now the women in years and the beers with old Errol, they took their toll, they took me from his side. He kissed me goodbye at the old Union Station. That's the last time I saw him, the last time I cried. Now I'm sitting alone in a house in Reseda, watching the late show as the moonlight streams in. And up on the screen, well, here comes my daddy. It's a sad, funny feeling. Now I'm older than him. So your daddies and daughters, your sons and your mothers, remember life is over before it begins. So hold one another and stand close together, as close as my dad did to old Errol Flynn.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming to celebrate our fabulous Russell. And thanks to all the other performers. Jen, we have a slight announcement. Is that correct? About something in a program? Are we going to do that?
If we can invite all of the performers to the stage.
All performers, please find your place on the stage.
And if everyone could turn to the last page of your program, we're all going to sing together. I think Russell would require that.
Calling all artists, please come to the stage. Best things in the theater are not planned. He would have loved this.